You're about to listen to Enthusiastically Self-Employed, the podcast created for you as a coach, consultant, speaker, and or author. I created this podcast for those of us who are enthusiastic about growing our business and learning along the way. My name is Brenda Mellor, and I'm your host. Prior to becoming enthusiastically self-employed, I was a corporate marketer who always admired those who were self-employed. Through this podcast, I'll share my learnings and expert guest interviews with you. You'll learn business, marketing, and LinkedIn tips to help you as a solopreneur or small business owner. Remember to follow this show to get the newest podcast episodes loaded into your podcast player of choice. Now let's get started. Good morning, LinkedIn, YouTube, and Facebook. My name is Brenda Mellor, and I am the host of this wonderful show. I like to call it Enthusiastically Self-Employed because I, my friends, am enthusiastically self-employed, and I like to bring on awesome folks like Annie Meehan to talk about techniques and tips that can help you to be enthusiastically self-employed as well. I want to say good morning to my very special guest, Annie Meehan. Hey, Annie, how are you doing today?
Good morning. I am doing fantastic because I am enthusiastically self-employed. So thank you. I'm doing great this morning. I love
that's
my
work. Awesome. I love it. And I, you know, I was thinking about this morning. I was getting my breakfast ready after walking the dog and doing some other things. And I'm like, it kind of like is hard to even remember corporate life, what I would be doing at this time of day if I still was in my corporate job. I might have been still driving. I'm not sure, doing all of those things. At any rate, I'm delighted to have you on with me here, Annie. I want to talk about how you and I know each other. We met in one of the, I think it was in one of the Speaker Friends Friday calls. Did I say that right? Is that what we call them?
Yep. That's it. Innovation Women. Yeah.
Through Innovation Women. Shout out to Innovation Women and to Bobby Carlton, a great organization. And one week I put out an ask and I said, hey, I'm looking to bring other people on my show. And I was doing a LinkedIn Live-a-thon and solo interviews. And you and I had a side conversation. And I said, you know what, let's do like a solo chat about this sometime. So Annie, before we jump into this discussion, I know a little bit about you, but I'd like for you to take a few minutes and tell us a bit more about you and your business, if you could.
Yeah. And I also, like you, left the corporate world, and we would probably definitely be sitting in traffic right now when you say, what would you be doing sitting in traffic, especially if it was snowing in Minnesota, where I lived for 40 years. So I spent 9 years in the financial world, climbing the corporate ladder with 5 promotions, and then had my third child and said, wait a minute, this is kind of out of control. I leave early, I come back late, and I don't love what I do anymore. So stayed home for a few years and then bought my first gym in a small town, my second gym in a big city. And through that, people started asking me like, hey, you're so inspiring. You're so motivational. What are you really going to do when you grow up? And I said, oh, I'm going to speak all over the world. And I heard a speaker named Nicole Johnson that really inspired me. And I felt like her message was so powerful. So I started speaking, and the more you speak, the more you speak, especially if you have a powerful message and an excellent delivery. And so I speak, I coach, I just finished my 8th book, I write workbooks, I do retreats, I get to do a lot of fun stuff. But ultimately, what I really do is I use the written and spoken word to inspire organizations and individuals. That's the bottom line. That's what I get to do.
That's awesome. And I love your vibe when we had our preliminary chat. I'm like, oh, this is going to be a fun conversation. And you can see if you're watching us now on screen, it says the pineapple principle. That's the topic for us for today. And I'm guessing probably 99% of the folks watching have no idea what we're talking about here. I'm going to say the 1%, maybe it's even higher than that, are people that know you and they've heard your talk about this before. But let's jump in here and tell us, Annie, what is the pineapple principle? And then let's talk a little bit about why it's important for us to know.
Yeah, the why and the how. So the pineapple principle came to me because, I don't even know, maybe in 2017 now, a friend was visiting from Chicago. I lived in Minnesota, and she called me. She's like, get to this store. There's a skirt you've got to have. And at the time, I always wore orange because orange is the symbol of happiness. So I always wore orange, and it was a bright orange skirt, but it was covered with pineapples. And I was like, I get the orange, but why the pineapples? And she said, Annie, you're such a pineapple. I'm like, what does that even mean? And she goes, don't you know the poem, stand up straight, wear a crown, and be sweet on the inside? Be a pineapple. So that's a pineapple poem. Wow. But for me, Brenda, really what I believe about all people is we all have a story, and then we all have a story behind our story. And so I just like sat with that. What does it mean to be a pineapple? And the fact that she saw me as one and I didn't know what it meant, I was like, I want to move into that. I want to really dive into being a pineapple person. So I thought, what does it mean to stand up straight? And I start thinking about in a world where we're attached to our phones, right?
We're hunched over, down, right?
Yeah. Hey, I'll get Brenda. Just give me a minute. Oh, Brenda, hi. Oh, there's someone more exciting than you. We're either looking down at our phones or we're distracted by somebody more interesting. And that's heartbreaking. And I feel like we're so disconnected in the world. People don't feel seen. They don't feel valued. They don't feel loved. And I know people want to work from home and we work from home, right? But there's also such an important time to connect, whether it's Friday morning with other speakers or whatever it is. And so I started thinking about if I stood up straight and if I taught other people to stand up straight, we would actually look in people's eyes. Not only would it be good for our posture, but we would look in people's eyes and people would feel seen. And I honestly think one of the most beautiful gifts you can give to another human being is to see them. And I started really being intentional, especially when I'm in cafes, I'm in a coffee shop, a waitress, a cashier, like really looking at how is your day really?
Like making eye contact and listening to them, right?
Listening, being present and seeing. And so standing up straight became really seeing people, right? And then I feel like, oh, there you go. I felt like then wear a crown. So I say tongue in cheek, somewhat seriously, if I have my choice every day, I want to lay in bed and eat donuts. Anybody else?
I mean, pick your dessert of choice, right?
Exactly. But then I'm like, wait a minute, I got a crown on. I'm super valuable. I'm going to get up and go for a walk. I'm going to drink a glass of water. I'm going to take care of myself. And it doesn't mean I don't occasionally have a donut, because I do, but I am going to take care of myself because I'm valuable. But part of this, and even the seeing, is first look in the mirror and see yourself. And I ask people, do you look in the mirror and think, oh my gosh, I'm so good looking. Like I can't even stand it. And people look at me and I'm like, I wish you did, instead of critiquing what's wrong with you. So it always starts with self. I see myself, therefore I can see others. I value myself, therefore I see the value in others. Mm-hmm. And what that sweet on the inside, which I thought was like, that's so cute. But I started thinking about one of our most dangerous weapons is the keyboard. I can sit home and say, Brenda, I don't like you. Brenda, you're wrong. Brenda, I'm right. Brenda, I'm going to unfriend you. We use the keyboard and our phone to text and to say things that we would never say face-to-face. At least most of us wouldn't. And I'm like, if you're sweet on the inside, what comes through your mouth, through your keyboard and through your text is kindness, love, and encouragement. First toward yourself again, and then toward the world. And I was like, I'm not really into the news or politics, but what if everybody was a pineapple person and they looked up, they valued themselves and others, they were sweet to themselves and others. Like we could change the whole world. And so that's kind of how the Pineapple Principle came to be. And so, yes, it's customer service. Yes, it's the international symbol of hospitality. But I'm like, when people hear me speak and then they put pineapples up in their room or in their office or in their classroom or on their team meeting, and then they're like, oh my gosh, Annie, we're all trying to be pineapple people. Like it's easy, instead of just be kind or 27 steps to be a good human being or whatever it is. Right. Just be a pineapple. It's a symbol, so it's easier to remember. It's visual because there is a crown on the pineapple, right? And so that's the Pineapple Principle. And what happened when I started living that out and why it became a book was the experiences of meeting a woman in a bathroom at 36 and, you know, her saying to me, you're the first woman that looked at me and didn't judge me, because she was scantily dressed. And she said, she was kind of scared of me at first. And she's like, why are you being kind? I'm like, why not? It's easier to be kind than to be mean. And a man who heard me speak at a conference that said, you know, I buried my wife 5 years ago, but the truth is I buried myself with her, and I've been raising my kids as a dead person, and I'm going to value myself and value them. And for me, that's that deeper meaning behind, yes, a poem, then a principle, but now an application of how and why to be a pineapple.
Yeah. Wow. So much to unpack inside there. And I don't know if you noticed it or if our viewers are watching it, but when you were talking about standing up straight, I kind of found myself hunching just a little bit. And I'm like, it caused me to you know, kind of lift my carriage up a bit and sit a little bit taller. And then you were talking about drinking water, and I have a water nearby. I'm like, I probably should take a sip of that. Right? I mean, it's things like that, you know, that help to build up our self-confidence. But I think also what I heard you say was the connection to other people. Mm-hmm. So when we're not hunched over looking at our phones and we're at the coffee shop and we're actually making eye contact and we're saying, how are you doing? No, really, how are you? Yeah. And listening to their response and making that human to human connection. I feel like technology is really great, Annie, and don't get me wrong, I love my phone and all that other good stuff. I love LinkedIn, of course, but I feel like sometimes we're losing touch with the human element. And you just gave us like a little mini TED talk almost, like a refresher and getting back to those basics of relationship building.
Yeah. I think one thing too, Brenda, that I've been saying to my husband a lot is I think as humans, we decide who's worthy of being seen. And if I value you because you're my friend, I'll notice you. But if you're just somebody that can offer me a service or a beverage, I may or may not pay attention. And I spent a week in Paris by myself in 2015. I was invited to speak there and I stayed for a week, but people told me, oh, the French people aren't nice and they're kind of snotty. And so I didn't know, you know, and I went to France. I've met the kindest people I've ever met in my life, truly.
That's nice.
I spoke the morning that I went. I got in 11 at night. I spoke at 7 in the morning the next morning. People lined up to ask me, can I go to breakfast with you, dinner, lunch? And a woman invited me to her home for dinner. Wow. And as I was going over there, I picked up a loaf of bread and I was thinking, she could be an axe murderer. Like, why am I don't know this woman at all. What am I doing? And I got to her house and I'm like, can I ask you something? Like, people told me people in Paris were not friendly. Like, what is the deal? What's happening here? Why is everyone being so nice to me?
Right.
And she said, and I will never forget this, it's so deep in my soul and spirit, as she said, you are kind. And I was like, what do you mean? And she said, well, a lot of Americans come and they're with someone else and they never even look up and they'll be like, how do I get to here? And tell me what, and they expect us to speak English. You do not speak French at all, but you apologize 100 times and you try, but you're terrible.
Are you fluent in French? Because I've heard that they get a bit annoyed with Americans who don't speak the language. And maybe that's another fallacy. Who knows?
Well, and what she said is, she said, they assume we have to speak English. Americans are rude, not French. And she said, you were so kind and you looked up to each one of us. You tried to speak French, but you can't at all. You paid attention. And she, and I, what I realized in that, a couple of things. One, I try to be intentional to see all people and not decide who's greater than the other. But two, looking up, like, it's so easy to just be like, help me with this or do this for me and value different people differently. But if you're really intentional about seeing all people as equal, they will feel that. You know, and people will mirror how we treat them. And that's what I think I learned the most was that I wanted to see people and they felt that. They were like, you slowed down. You looked at us where other people be like, teach us this or do this for us.
Yeah.
It was an awareness that I have the opportunity. Plus traveling alone is a really powerful thing because not just with the person you're with. You're open to whoever you meet. And I love to make new friends and meet new people. So yeah. Anyway,
I think that's so awesome. First of all, that you traveled solo, but traveled internationally solo and in a country where you weren't fluent in the language. I think that's as impressive as I'll get out there, Annie. And it's funny. I was talking to someone recently and they're from Seattle and you hear a lot about Seattle, the weather being really bad and it rains all the time and it's awful. And I'm going to give a shout out to my friend, Steve Miller, not the rock star, but a marketing guy, Steve Miller. And he's like, can I let you in on something? He's like, Seattle's actually beautiful, but that's what we tell everybody to keep the tourists out.
Exactly.
So maybe it's the same thing with Paris. Maybe they tell Americans that, you know, folks in Paris are rude, so to keep the Americans out from the tourist spot on there. But it sounds like what you're just saying is they're just reflecting back upon those interpersonal exchanges that are happening, or maybe the lack of those happening there, right?
Yeah. And I had never been to Europe. I went for 3 weeks by myself, Brenda, actually, but I had the opportunity to speak in Amsterdam and my daughter was there studying. So I got to meet up with her. And I spent a week alone in Spain, but I got to visit the families that I had done foreign exchange for through 5 summers. I had kids come from Spain. And then I went to France and spoke by myself and then traveled. And it's a different experience. It keeps you more open. And I don't take public transportation. So I would walk like 20 miles a day, but I would just walk it. I couldn't read the sign. So I would just walk everywhere. And I would like find a cafe and meet a person and meet someone else. And it was an extraordinary, I met famous people that like wanted to get their photo with me. I mean, like, it was really an amazing trip of a lifetime. So yeah.
That sounds like it. Now, when you go and talk, I have to ask, because you're a speaker and there might be other people in the audience that are also speakers.
Yeah.
Are you speaking about the pineapple principle, or what is your talk about or is it a variety of different topics?
Yeah, I have a variety of topics. I'm super grateful. I'm leaving here on the 5th and I'm traveling and speaking all over till the 27th. So this is my longest like tour going, but I speak on the pineapple principle. I usually try to close my messages with the pineapple principle because the pineapple principle to me is about being authentic. So the first 20 years of my life, I didn't want to just be like someone else. I wanted to be anyone else. I had a rather disruptive upbringing. And so when I learned to like myself and that anyone and everyone can be a pineapple person, it's kind of how I close. But what I speak on primarily right now is Choose to Soar, which is about navigating disruption professionally, personally, and literally, and kind of soaring above our circumstances. So Affected by the Hurricane inspired the book. That's my eighth book that just came out. But I want to show people, like, what if it's not just surviving or thriving, but literally soaring above? What does that mean? What does it look like in organizations, in culture, and in individuals? And then Be the Exception was my book in 2016. And in 17, it won a national award. So I often still get asked to speak on that. And it's seven keys of transformation of mindset and dealing with change. And then I do Exceptional Goals, which is about setting goals beyond yourself. So when people set a goal, owning gyms, a lot of people are like, I want to lose weight. I was like, who cares? What difference does it make? But if you say, I want to swim with my grandkids, or I want to be healthy because my sister's diagnosed with cancer, well, I can help you with that. But I don't help with the weight loss. I help with the mindset and the habits. And sometimes a side effect is weight loss, right? And I also speak on H3 cultures, which really came into play with workplace culture being separated when people started working from home. And then people were negative and anxious and depressed, and companies didn't know how to bring them back together connected. So I'm always, even when I speak at corporate events, I'm always speaking to the individual and how we take care of ourselves so that we can serve the organization better, which affects the workplace culture. A lot on disruption and change is what I speak about. So, yeah.
I love it. And you just sound like you're just like this ball of inspirational energy. I feel like I want to see Annie speaking, because I feel like even in this solo talk that we're doing here today, you can get the vibe and you get a bit of a flavor of what you speak about. So is speaking primarily your business, or do you also work training teams and things like that? Or is it mainly speaking conferences and for organizations?
Yeah, keynote is my primary part of my business. So I tend to either kick off a conference or close a conference, but I also do trainings and breakouts and retreats. I coach individuals. I consult with small teams. Like I said, I just wrote my eighth book. I now have two workbooks, which I just released my second workbook last week. I have an online course. So really, I just feel like every day I want to work with people. So sometimes it's small, and I don't care if it's 6 or 6,000. I'm always like, okay, how do I serve more people? How can this message help an organization, help an individual, help a team? And I'm grateful because a lot of my clients, after they hear me, they refer me or they'll bring me back. So I know I'm doing the right work.
That's a testament to it. And I want to just rewind a little bit, because I heard you say it once or twice. You've written eight books. Yeah. Now, I wrote one. It's called Social Media Pie. It's kind of sitting behind me yonder over here. But I've got ideas for like three more books, and then maybe a refresh. Someday it'll be a Social Media Pie second edition coming out. But eight books. You're a machine, Annie. Are you self-published? Are you working with a publishing
house? I am a machine, but not just as a writer. I'm just a machine because I'm so driven and I feel like I have so much to do and life is short. So I always have a coach. So I'm dyslexic and I have ADHD. So writing is really hard for me. Spelling is hard for me. Reading is hard for me. But when I speak, audiences ask for things. And I always feel like if I can help one person, I'm going to do it. So I always have a coach. My most recent coach on Choose to Soar was, where is it? So this is a thicker book. This is actually my biggest book. It's 230 pages. Okay. Was Rachel Ryan. So she helps me. So we meet. I do a lot of audiobooks. Do a
is
lot
she
of
like a self-publishing coach, or what kind of a coach is
yes,
she?
Yes, a self-publishing coach, a writing coach, a book editor. And then she kind of has people. I've also worked with Wise Inc. on my book two and book three. And then I've self-published and just worked with editors. But I like to have a coach because when I start working with them, like in this book, we started in January and I said, I would like to have it done by June. Be the Exception. We started in September and I wanted to have it done by March. So when I hire a coach, part of the reason is to have a deadline, because of my speaking and my travel, it's easy for me to put writing to the side if I don't have someone saying, what are you doing this week? What are you working on? So it just helps me stay accountable to produce. I have three other books I've started. My husband would like me to take a year off from writing.
But, I'm sure, right? You're like, you want to cross over the 10 threshold and, you know, then go up to the dozen, right?
I don't know. It's more like, I don't even like writing. It's like, I start talking about someone and someone's like, will you write a book on that? And I'm like, I think so.
Yeah.
And then I kind of figure out, like, people, when you get done speaking, I sell a lot of books at the back of the room. I know it's not everybody's thing. But for me, when I get done speaking and people are like, I want more, Annie, and I as an individual can't afford to hire you as a coach or as a speaker, but do you have books I can take home? Do you have things I can keep applying and reminding myself? And so that is really why I really do
write. To reach new audiences, right? Those folks that maybe can't afford to, or their company is not in a position to hire you to speak. I love it. So I think that was a gem you just dropped. And I want to just kind of replay that again when you said, I work with a coach because the coach keeps me on deadline. And I think that's where a lot of authors, or would-be authors even, maybe I don't want to say fail, but aren't able to meet their mark. Because you'll say you want to write a book. And that was me for years. I'm going to write a book. I mean, I had people similar to you at the end of a conference or my talk, they would come up to me and say, do you have a book about this? Can I, you know, do you have a LinkedIn book? Can I buy your book? And I'm looking around. I'm like, I don't have a book. Hey, I should do that. And we all say that someday I'm going to write a book. It's on my bucket list. It's on my to-do list. And I think similar for me, I worked with a self-publishing coach and we had a timeline, you know, similar to yours. It was a 3 to 6 month process from start to finish, but working with a coach actually gets it done and gets it off of your to-do list. Have you ever worked on has it been a collaboration with other authors, or have you only written solo books for the 8?
No, the 8 are all solo. I have other books that I've contributed to, but I don't promote those. I don't know why. I just, one of them is like the world's greatest speakers. So I probably should put it on my website because I was interviewed for. Yeah. And one was like empowered women around the world. I do think, Brenda, 100%. And so many people say to me, I want to write a book. And I say, that's awesome. But unless you have a plan, you will never write a book. And I'm not judging you. I know how hard it is. Millions of people say they want to write a book. 1% write them. And of that, 1% ever produce and print and publish. So I know how hard it is. And I am a coach and I help people with transformation, all these things. But I also 100% believe we should have coaches that take us to the next level, or that have expertise in LinkedIn, in book publishing, in whatever it is. And having a coach for me helps me be able to be successful in all areas of my life, because I know when it's time to onboard someone else to do a different project so I can keep going. And when I'm on the road, I can't let my project stop because I'm traveling or speaking. I've got to, okay, what am I writing? Who needs a handout? Who needs this? Who needs that? And so, 100%. So you worked with the coach as well to get your book done?
Yeah, to get the book. I mean, just to get the process done. And I actually met him I'm in Michigan. So Rochester, Michigan, there's a Rochester's Writers Conference every year. And I was invited to speak about LinkedIn for Authors. Okay. And at the event, there was a gentleman in the room. And afterwards, I went out to the lobby because, you know, us introverts, are you an introvert or an extrovert, Annie?
I'm pretty extrovert, but I do, when I'm traveling like this and I come home, I'm like, I cannot talk to anyone for 24 hours.
Right? I don't know. I was trying to read you. I'm like, I think she's an extrovert, but for me, I'm an introvert. That doesn't mean I don't like speaking. I do love speaking. And I just know that when I'm done speaking, I need some quiet time. So after my talk, I went out into the lobby area and there was only a handful of people working on laptops, doing phone calls, drinking their coffee. And he was sitting across and I said, weren't you in my session? And he said, yeah. And I said, what did you think? You know, you're always looking for that immediate feedback as a speaker. What did you think? He's like, oh, it was great. And we got into a conversation. And I said, what do you do? And he said, you know, well, I'm an author and I wrote a book, you know, called How to Write a Book in 30 Days. And I'm like, the universe brought me into this room to sit across from this man. And I ended up buying his book and then hiring him to be my self-publishing coach going through the process. So I think similar to you, when we go back to this topic of the pineapple principle, had I just gone out in the lobby to just be quiet and face the windows and not made eye contact with anyone, I would have missed out on that whole exchange and opportunity to have a conversation. His name's Don Staley, and to work with him to get my book project done. So what I'd like to do now, Annie, is change gears a little bit. And I want to invite our audience into the discussion. And we're here today talking about the pineapple principle. But as is common with my guests, sometimes we veer into different directions. We've been talking about public speaking. We've been talking about Annie being an international traveler. We've been talking about the fact that she published 8 books, and that is impressive as all get out. And I want to invite our audience, if you have any comments or questions for Annie, to please bring them into the conversation. Go ahead and drop a comment in. I have to give a shout out, Annie, to my good friend, John Espirian. John is in the UK. But if you look at John's profile, he has a secret word which he encourages people to reference when they invite him to connect. And the word is pineapple. So as it would turn out, And John, I'm not sure if you were watching from the beginning of the show or not, but if not, get a chance to play back the Pineapple Principle. But maybe, Annie, could you refresh us on what the Pineapple Principle is for those folks that maybe joined us a few minutes late?
Yes, it is. The Pineapple Principle is someone called me a pineapple. They taught me the poem and I realized stand up straight means see people. Wear a crown means value yourself and others, and be sweet on the inside means use your keyboard, your phone, and your mouth to use kind, encouraging, and loving words to people all over the world.
There, just wanted to give you a heads up. I know you're listening to this show because you're probably self-employed, but there's a chance you might be working, but looking for a new career. If so, I'd like to invite you to come on out to my upcoming free live webinar. I've got two sessions available, Thursday, March 14th at 7 p.m. or Saturday, March 16th at 11 a.m. Now, these sessions are great for those of you who are working, but considering looking for a new career in 2024. That might be you, or maybe it's someone you know in your network. If so, I want you to direct them to mellermarketing.com/stealth, and they can register for my free live webinar. I'm going to teach you all the tricks in my book about how to get the most out of LinkedIn for your job search if you're working but looking, and you're also experience rich. That means you're age 40 plus, 50 plus, or 60 plus. Again, go to mellermarketing.com/stealth. That's great. And I love it. And I don't know, John, if that's where you came up with the word pineapple for your profile or not, or if it's just coincidental. But John strikes me as that kind of person, too. He does a great job of connecting with people in his community and on LinkedIn and, you know, representing all those things that you just talked about. Shauna, I agree with you, Shauna. Shauna is saying so inspiring that she's followed through with writing all these books. And I love the stat that you shared, Annie, too. You said, like, what was it? Only 1% of people will actually write a book, and then 1% of that 1% will actually follow through with
and
the methodology.
The book. Yeah, because people write them. Some people write them or start to write them. And the coolest thing to me, Shauna, is that I was told at 21 not to go to college, that I was illiterate because I'm a terrible speller. And so I like to journal, but I never intended to write a book because my spelling's so bad. And thank goodness there's tools and people that help with that stuff today. But I love that when I get to meet individuals or parents of individuals that have ADHD or dyslexia, and they meet me and they go, wait a minute, you wrote a book? You wrote more than one book? You've written 8 books? And so, Shauna, I think the biggest inspiring thing for me is that I thought I was stupid for the first half of my life, you know, and being able to know not only am I not stupid, but I don't have a disability. I learn different, but I'm capable and I'm smart and strong and I can write books and I can teach people with written and spoken words. So thank you for your kind words, because I think we need to recognize that we get to inspire each other and that that's a privilege by the work we do in this world. So, yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm going through comments and I had to look on LinkedIn. So that's why I was looking off to the side. So I'm trying to figure out who this person is, and it's a gray avatar. And that is either because your privacy settings are set up so it's not public, or your third party applications are not shared properly. That's why. But this is Allison, who was at TEDx Detroit last week. And I have to say, share this with you, Allison, but also Annie, maybe you can relate to, now that we're getting back out into the real world again, and we're conferences and events are kind of back in full force. I'm finding, you know, and people like Allison, like I know, I've interacted with Allison a lot. I see her, I hug her, I'm making small talk with people. And then I see other people, it's like, I find as I get older, Annie, my mental Rolodex is moving a little bit slower. And I'm like, I know you, and I know that we know each other, and we've had thoughtful, like I'm blanking completely on their name and how I know the person. And I even had a couple of people come up to me at TEDx last week, Brenda, how are you doing? And you know, if their name tag was flipped over, I was like, John! You too, Annie. It's not just me.
Oh, it's totally me. And especially as a speaker, you know, we are sharing our stories and talking to audiences full of people. And then they feel like they know you or they follow you on social media. And I always feel bad, but I've really learned to be more comfortable. Even if people really act like they know me very well, I'll just say, I'm so sorry. I meet so many people. I have so much on my mind. Can you remind me what your name is? And I find most people don't mind at all. Like, I'm Brenda. Oh, okay. Great to see you again, Brenda. I recognize your face, but I couldn't remember exactly who you were. So I did a TEDx on the Pineapple Principle, but instead of calling it the Pineapple Principle, I called it Lessons from a Pineapple. And that was my TEDx in Vero, Florida a couple years ago. Have you done a TEDx, Brenda?
I have not yet. Someday. So we'll leave it at that. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah.
Shauna, here's a big tip. Speak. And what I mean by that is this. When I started this, so I've been speaking for 20 years, but professionally for 10. So I get paid. The difference is public speaking is free. Professional speaking is paid. And even if you're a professional speaker, instead of saying free, if they don't have a budget, say, I'll do this pro bono in exchange for a list of who's here or video or a book or whatever. You can find something to exchange.
But you can negotiate. And can I add something onto that too, Annie? And by the way, for those that are listening on the podcast, the question was from Shauna. It said, what are some tips you would give someone who wanted to start doing more public speaking? I always like to read it just in case people who are watching, they're like, what are they talking about right now? As I've heard this tip, and I have not done this yet, but I think I should start doing it. If you're asked to speak and they don't have a budget and you do what Annie does, you negotiate a copy of their list or testimonials or other things. And I can't remember where I read this from, but send them an invoice with your regular speaker rate. Yes. Crossed out, and it's an invoice for zero, and then make a note, one time, I don't want to say one time discount, but you know, pro bono in exchange for X, Y, and Z. So you're still demonstrating to them, this is a $3,500 talk, I'm giving it to you, but yeah. I want you to know it's a $3,500 talk. Have you heard of that technique, Annie?
100%. I use that. Yeah. So I always invoice for the full fee, and whether okay. I'm giving them a discount or it's a pro bono event, which I do four of those a year, then I write that and I'll say in exchange for the list of so on and so forth. I wanted to answer a little more. Was it Renee? Was that the woman
speaking? Shauna
that we just remember named. So what I want to say to you, Shauna, is a couple things. One, I see you're an RN. So I'm sure you have tons of tremendous stories. For years, I facilitated the academy to teach people to go from public speaking to professional. So my biggest thing is speak. And what I mean by that is set up a coffee shop is how I started moving to paid speaking is I set up a coffee shop and I invited people. I invited two other speakers to join me. We each spoke 20 minutes. We had the room for 2 hours. Everybody got a network and introduced themselves, say what they were looking for. Then we spoke for 20 minutes. I always got comment cards. What did you like? What would you do differently? I was in the learning process. But then as I spoke more, whether it was a rotary or a chamber, one important thing for you, especially, I don't know what you speak on, but as a nurse, I'm sure you have tons of stories and all of us have stories. The really important thing, the difference between public and professional speaking is public speaking, I will listen to you. Professional speaking, I want to learn from you. So I want to learn how to have humor in crisis. I want to learn how to make a transformation from a job loss to climbing the corporate ladder. So in professional speaking, we're always teaching something that benefits the audience. Even if we tell our story, we want to teach them. So I started speaking at rotaries, at churches, at chambers, in coffee shops, whatever I could. But every Tuesday I spoke somewhere and I'd say, I'll speak for free. I just want to speak. But from those comment cards became, oh, I have an organization you can speak at. Oh, my husband works at this company. Oh, my wife works at this company. And from that, I speak 50 to 100 times a year paid now. But it's taken me, you know, I've done this for 10 years now and I spoke for 10 years for free. So just something to think about, but just start speaking.
And I do hear that with a lot of people. And I would echo that as well. When I first started doing speaking, I was taking any speaking opportunity I could, whether it was paid or non-paid. And I'll be honest with you, Annie, I wasn't even asking to get paid. I wasn't asking, do you have a speaker budget or what do you normally pay your speakers? I wasn't quoting them. I was just saying yes. And I assumed it was non-paid and they never said anything any different. And then as I got more confident, and even now I tend to turn away unpaid speaking opportunities unless it's a good fit. Unless they never pay speakers, because if they pay speakers some of the time, I want to be one of those people. And I think that's one of the things that we learned through Innovation Women is that, you know, we should always be asking for payment for our services. And we should, I think we've also talked about in the group, sometimes there's speaking opportunities where they ask you to pay. Like, how crazy is that? Come to our event and speak and you pay us $1,500. Like, what? Why would I pay you? And then you're charging ticket prices on top of it. So we're learning techniques like that. That I love the thought of asking to pay to speak, but I love your thought as well of negotiating some other, like whether it's the attendee list, or I imagine you secure testimonials and recommendations on a regular basis, right?
No, I wish I could say yes to that. I used to be better at it. And actually I had a bureau reach out to me yesterday and they're like, we want 3 written testimonials in the last 3 months. And I was like, oh my gosh. I mean, sometimes I get so busy that I forget to do that, but I had really 3 great clients last week. So I think that they will all three write beautiful testimonials. I'm hopeful for. Another thing I've learned to ask is, what are you paying other speakers? And I've been really grateful. My clients have been amazing to be transparent with me, because they'll offer me something and I'll just ask. I just say, can I ask, you know, what I know this guy that's right. speaking at your conference as well, what are you paying him? And mm-hmm. often it's more than what they've offered me. And I'll just say, you know, I know the value that I will bring to your attendees. Right. I promise you. And I would really love to be matched. And every single time they've said, oh, we can do that. And so yeah. I think it's really important as a woman speaker, especially, to ask. And I spoke at a conference a couple of weeks ago now, and they were saying, you know, we've had professional football players, and I'm not teasing you guys, because I know I have speaker friends that are retired professional athletes, but they said they did not connect with us. But you, Annie, you connected in a way that yeah. we have not had a speaker in 10 years understand our job, understand what we're going through. And I know that some of the organizations that sometimes you get to work with, they're paying their employees way less than what you're asking to be paid as a professional speaker. But that's why you have to be so dynamic and detailed, and give strategies for that audience to take right? what you yeah. taught and then pour it into them. So it really affects them personally and professionally, and affects the organization. So there's an ROI on that. Yeah. So sometimes it's hard to see, but so important yeah. to ask for about.
Absolutely. And I'm going to change gears just a little bit off of speaking and talk about the ADHD, because I love that you mentioned that. And I think sometimes just talking about these things helps to normalize them, right? And yeah. this is coming from Dwight. I'm looking on LinkedIn, and I'll drop the comment in there, Dwight, so you can adjust your settings. That's why we're seeing your gray avatar and LinkedIn user for you. But Dwight says, while your message resonates so well, are there any resources, Annie, that you would recommend for those dealing with ADHD? What are your thoughts there?
Absolutely. 100%. There's a lot. And one of my main questions I ask people today is, what's in your medicine cabinet? And by that, I mean, what do you use to care for yourself? So there's three things I use. I am not a doctor. I'm not a therapist. I am a certified coach. But these are my three things that I recommend for ADHD. Number one, there's an app called Sensei. It's S-E-N-S-A, I believe. And every day it gives you like a 3-minute tool to kind of rate yourself and be aware of yourself. The second thing is, I use Brilla. Brilla is a non-prescription medication that you can take. And it recommends, I probably shouldn't even say that, but it like recommends a lot, like 4 pills a day. And at certain times, I'm not really good at following rules. So I take one in the morning, and that works for me. And what it does is just help you focus and remember a little better. The third thing is, I move my body. Movement is not a choice for me. It is my medicine. It is in my medicine cabinet. It's not always because I feel like it. I walk every day. It calms my mind. It clears my mind. I am older than I want to be. No, I'm middle age. I would say I'm middle age. And I've learned these tools too. So I have a son with really severe ADHD, and it's really, really hard for him. And there's a lot of natural products today that you can take. But I really think one of the best medicines is movement. So walking yeah. every single day, 5 minutes to an hour, doesn't matter. And that Sensei app is interesting. Like I like learning about it, because a lot of people do tell me. And if you have ADHD, you are likely to have addiction issues or dyslexia. There's a lot of combinations, but releasing that stress can be so calming to the mind and help us think better. So I hope those help you. I also wear my watch to bed. And one thing I know is I need 6 hours of sleep a night, which isn't a ton, but if I don't get that, I take a nap during the day, even for 20 minutes. And that helps my brain focus, because I do get things done. I am strategic. It's harder for me than some people. So.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that. And so many great resources in there. I did look up Sensa app, and it was the right spelling of it. Okay. So we got the right name inside. Thank you. And really great advice. We've talked about so many great topics here today, Annie. And as we start to wrap, I'm going to pull up your LinkedIn profile up on screen. And I want to ask the question, Annie, are you open to connecting with individuals who are watching the live today? And if so, do you have any instructions for them on anything they need to do when they invite you to connect?
No, I pretty much try to connect with everybody, because I figure if my words or my videos or my books or my presentations can help one person every day, that's why I do what I do. I'm super passionate about all people, but really about men and mental health. My father drank himself to death. My brother took his life, and then his son took his life. And if I can break stigma and get people to talk and heal, that's why I do the good work I get to do every day. So I'd love to connect with any and all of you on LinkedIn. Yeah, I try to follow up right away and just connect and say hello. But yes, please reach out. Please ask questions. I'm happy to encourage you on your journey as a speaker, an individual, an organization.
Okay, so I want to point out, I have her profile up on screen for those of you watching this on video right now. Now, I can tell just by looking at her profile that Annie has creator mode turned on, and I have an experienced eye. I'm a LinkedIn coach, but I think a lot of people are figuring this out now. When you see a list of talks about and a list of hashtags underneath their profile, you're going to notice that their default button will say follow and not connect. Now, I'm already connected with Annie. That's why I see message. But from your view, for the audience, if you're visiting Annie's profile today, you're going to see follow instead of connect. If you want to connect with Annie, you can, but you've got to click on the more button. And then underneath, in your view, you'll see a list of options, one of which will either say personalize, invite, or connect. And then when you invite her to connect, just say, hey, I saw you on Brenda's show. Just name drop me and she'll know who I am. And yes, she'll remember the show that you're on. Now, Annie, I got to ask a question because your name field, I love the little microphones, by the way, but see, I'm guessing that's a speaker designation, but what does CSB stand for?
Yeah, and it was so important to me to achieve that coming from the financial world where you see CFP a lot, Certified Financial Planner. So I'm a certified speaking professional. Less than 17% of people in the world, for speakers in the world, have that distinction. So it's a rather rigorous accomplishment. They evaluate your speaking, but from your clients to your fees, making sure you're making enough money, making sure you're speaking enough and you're doing an excellent job. And it's 5 years of consistent speaking 50 times a year or more, and wow, earning 50,000 or excess from speaking a year. And so it's rather rigorous. And I earned that in 2020, which was amazing because I lost 110 speaking engagements. So I received the celebration in 21, but I actually earned it in 20. So I always say that's my good thing that came out of a devastating COVID year is I earned my CSP.
Well, that is really important. And I knew it had something to do with speakers, especially because it's bookended by the two microphones on there, but very impressive. I went through Toastmasters myself, which it's more of a training ground. It's not necessarily a certification path, although you do earn achievements, you know, competent communicator, things like that. But I'll have to look into that program. Sounds very interesting. So, maybe others might want to look as well. Go ahead.
Yes. So I say Toastmasters is a great place to get practice and to learn confidence. NSA is the National Speakers Association, and you have to be a member of the National Speakers Association. And the distinction is something you must apply for and then work through. You have 10 years time frame that you can earn it, but you need 5 years consecutive of success as a professional speaker.
So the CSP is a designation given by NSA.
Yeah.
Is that what I heard you say?
Yeah. Given by and earned by. You have to earn it to achieve it. So lots
earned,
of...
I'm telling this. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like when people say, I was given a college degree. You did not. You earned that college degree. Yes. They didn't just hand it to you for paying tuition. You had to earn that degree. So a good designation there.
Yeah. And so you have to be a member and then you apply and you go through this process and you have to track. Another thing somebody was asking about beginning speaking, track. Track everywhere you speak, track when you speak, track what you got paid, track their email, their phone number. You never know if they're going to come back. I have clients that hired me 7 years ago that are still like, we want you back again. We love you. Or we forgot about you and we remembered you. So track it all. And whether you sell one book for $20 or you get booked for $10,000, tracking that proves to you it's not just a hobby, it's a business as that money starts to come in.
So. You just made me think, I haven't done that. I did that when I first started speaking, but I haven't done that in a while. Like list all of your speaking engagements out along with the dollar value of that. And I think that can help to build confidence too, right?
100%.
Into where you're at. And I don't know. I mean, I think a lot of us experienced that dip that you're talked about during the pandemic. You know, some of us were able to pivot to virtual talks. Some of us didn't want to do it, you know, different types of opportunities. But now that things are coming back, I think we're definitely, I mean, even seeing a little bit of that cycle coming back too. It's almost like in some aspects, the budgets aren't as big as they used to be. Yeah. And I'm still trying to avoid the non-paid, but I'm finding sometimes I have to accept lower rates than I had pre-pandemic. But in the interest of getting back out there, to your point, Annie, one speaking engagement could lead to multiple speaking engagements with the right people in the room. So a really good point. All right. I want to wrap us up here and I want to show your website. Is this the right one? AnnieMeehan.com. Did I get that right?
Yep.
All right. And we talked about this a little bit earlier, but love your enthusiasm and your energy, Annie. And I'm sure others feel the same as well. There might be somebody watching this video, listening to this podcast that's thinking, hey, I want to work with Annie. I know you do keynotes and presentations, but can you remind us what are the different services and offerings that you have?
Yeah, I do individual coaching if it's an individual person. So I help people with transformation in lots of areas of their life, from finances to career to relationships to health.
I love it. Well, Annie, this was such a great conversation. I'm going to replay this and listen to all the gems that you dropped for us here again today. But any final comments for us talking about the pineapple principle before we wrap up?
Yeah, I would love if you're going to be a pineapple person with me is what I call it. Then you would put that in the comments. Like, I'm going to be a pineapple person. I agree to see value and be sweet to myself and to other people. I would love that. Because really, I have these bracelets. I have these stickers. I have tattoos. And I'm like, I'm trying to start a pineapple movement where a million people say, I will intentionally be a pineapple person every day and see value and be sweet to myself and others. Because I think we could change the world for the better.
Are you finding now that you're talking about pineapple, like people are gifting you pineapple things, or they find pineapple mugs or t-shirts or memes about pineapple, they'll send them to you? Are you finding that?
I definitely am super grateful. I'm not complaining. I love gifts and I love pineapple stuff. So yes, I get a lot of gifts. But more than anything, what I really love is people email me and message me through social media and just say, I saw this and I thought of you. I saw this and I thought of you. And really, I encourage speakers, find your symbol. Because no matter how much I love you, Brenda, I'll be like that one girl and like LinkedIn thing. But if they go the pineapple woman, people go, oh, Annie. And they have connected that. And it's been an easy way to be memorable as a speaker, especially at large conferences. So find your symbol.
Well, Annie, I love our talk today. I'm hoping at some point we'll be able to be at the conference, a conference together and speaking maybe on separate stages and have the chance to meet in person. Okay. Love your energy. But I just want to say thank you again for joining us. Such a delightful conversation.
Thank you so much for having me. This was great.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And as we wrap, I want to thank our audience for watching. And could you do us a favor? Annie and I are both self-employed, so that means we don't get performance reviews anymore. So we only know we did a good job if you tell us that you enjoyed the talk. So before you leave, drop a comment, let us know. And if you have not yet posted on LinkedIn this week, this month, heck, maybe even this year, as soon as the video is done playing, you'll see a little share icon at the bottom of it. Click to share and share the video along. Tell people something that you learned by watching this video. Or maybe tell people why they should watch this video if they're thinking about publishing a book or becoming a public speaker or weaving something like pineapple into their personal brand, right? Make sure that you tag Annie and myself when you do so. Remember to tag, you use the at symbol, and then the names will come up in the dropdown. Annie, I'll see you on Speaker Friend Friday. Will you be on this week?
I'm speaking at a conference.
Oh, bummer. That's right. You said you were traveling. I'll see you in the future at a Speaker Friend Friday. But in the meantime, have a great travel series.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
All right, everyone. Take care. Stay safe and stay healthy. We'll see you on LinkedIn. Bye-bye. Thanks for listening to today's episode of Enthusiastically Self-Employed. If you're looking to get a bigger slice of the LinkedIn pie, I'd like to give you a free resource to check out. It's my 15 Tips for Coaches and Consultants checklist. Go to mellormarketing.com/the-list, that's THELIST, and you can download your copy today. By doing so, I will give you some quick and easy tips to update your LinkedIn profile today to help to generate more leads for your coaching and consulting business. Again, that's mellormarketing.com/the-list.